Joining us is Emil Guillermo. He's the host of the PETA podcast, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. And you can also read him every week over at the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund. What is the website called?
It's aldef.org/blog, mm-hmm. David. It's the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund blog, and I've been writing there for almost, 8 years. I actually going on to my 9th year there now.
Well, you cover a lot of stories, both for PETA and ALDEF, and you're a great journalist. Let's talk about the Filipinos who live in America.
Yeah, the Filipinos, they are standing up to Trump, you know, and this is the thing that's really ironic, because of all the surveys of Asian Americans, and there aren't that many, but the ones who are most pro-Trump are, can you guess which ones?
No.
Well, I mean, the Vietnamese, because a lot of them are very conservative.
They're being shipped back to Vietnam.
Right. And now they're being shipped back. That's irony of ironies, right? Mm-hmm. But then, so there's the Vietnamese, and close. It used to be the Vietnamese were number one Republican supporters. But the Filipinos have come out of nowhere to become the number one Asian American group. And now, just within the last couple of weeks, we have examples of Asian Americans or Filipinas, female Filipinos, who are standing up to Trump and as examples of what people should do. So the first one is the Supreme Court Justice of California, Tani Cantil Sacaulle, the first Asian Filipina Chief Justice of California. She has renounced the Republican Party. And said it's because of Trump, it's because of Kavanaugh, it's because of all that.
And the LGBTQ stuff, too, right?
And the LGBTQ, yes. And, you know, the thing that's ironic is that, you know, she's really a pretty, you know, modern conservative Filipina in the sense that she's a Republican and she was appointed by Schwarzenegger. But, you know, the Filipinos are reasonable people. We're not, we like to see all sides. And finally, you know, the straw that broke the camel's back, and we'll talk about idioms like that.
Yeah. Yeah, let me write that down.
We got to spare the camels. But, you know, the last straw was Trump and you know, all his lying and his lack of defense of the rule of law, but primarily also because Trump went after the judges.
Yeah.
And so Chief Justice Cantil Sacaulle has been one of the really most prominent Republicans to come out of late. And, you know, what's odd is that everyone has something bad in their resume that they've said about Trump. Yeah, even the guy who is, you know, being considered for chief of staff, Mulvaney, he called Trump a terrible human being. And now, you know, he's going to be, you know, his chief of staff.
Maybe that was a compliment.
Yeah, well, you know, who knows now? But so Cantil Sacaulle, you know, we have to tip our hat off to her because, you know, she has come out. The other one who we need to look to as an example is Maria Ressa, who is the chief executive of Rappler, which is a Filipino website, and has been one of the leading voices in the Philippines against the extrajudicial killings, which Human Rights Watch has put at about 12,000 now.
You're talking about Duterte.
Right. The extrajudicial killings of Duterte, when he goes after the drug problem, his answer has been to be extra zealous in terms of law enforcement, which means you kill everyone. Mm-hmm. And there's no justice. I mean, I guess there's some savings there. You know, there's no court cases, but there's no justice. And guess who's been really, you know, cheering this on? You know, from his perch as the leader of the free world, who really loves what Duterte is doing.
Yeah.
Yeah. But none other than, right? Donald Trump has time and time again held up Duterte as one of his favorite autocrats, which really, you know, you have to... Yeah, you begin to see the pattern, right? And mm-hmm. Macron's having his problem in France. Who's standing up for democracy? You're right. You know, England has its problems. You know, Germany.
Mexico.
They're standing tall. You're right.
Obrador.
Right. Mexico is, and they weren't expecting that to happen. But so, we have to tip our hat to Maria Ressa. She, you know, has been harassed. She's been threatened with, well, they charge her with tax fraud, and she's fighting that. They don't credential her publication, so they can't, you know, officially cover, you know, what Duterte is doing there in the Philippines. But there was Maria Ressa on the cover of Time magazine, along with The Guardians. It was sort of a group thing this year with Jamal Khashoggi, the slain Washington Post columnist, the two journalists from Reuters who were jailed in Myanmar, and then of course the journalists from the Capital Gazette who were gunned down, and the whole staff there that continues to do their job. So, you know, those are the examples we need at this holiday time when we see lies sort of dominating the news. What do we do about the lies? Well, we don't have to stand for the lies. We can stand up to the lies, and those are two examples of Filipinas standing up. And the third Filipina that I want to mention is Miss Universe, because there she was. You know, Donald Trump had me watching Miss Universe on Sunday mm-hmm. night. I mean, that was his baby. And, you know, he's getting dumped on for lying and for all the things that could make him a co-conspirator, an unindicted co-conspirator here, and Cohen's going to jail, and Flynn could be going. Well, Flynn may catch a little forbearance when he gets sentenced this week. But, you know, Trump, just to get away from it all, you know, he probably spent a little time watching Miss Universe, because that was his thing. That, you know, he mm-hmm. when he was in charge, he didn't have to worry about, oh, you know, let's go see the girls as they dress or undress. And he'd have to worry about that. He can go in, you know, when he was in charge. He didn't have to worry about going into a Russian apartment or a Russian hotel and worry about cameras, you know, observing his every move. He didn't have to worry about any of that. But now here he is. Once again, you know, the leader of the free world, you got to think that he just hates his life now. Or, I don't know, maybe he loves it, but watching the Miss Universe pageant probably brought him back to the time when he can just oogle the girls and, you know, do what he wants, because, you know, he could only hurt himself, mm-hmm. you know, no one else. And actually, you know, it reminds me of the SNL sketch, right? You know, where they talked about It's a Wonderful Life. What if Donald Trump had never been elected? And what did they do? I mean, Donald Trump tweeted the next morning that, oh, these guys should be investigated. Like, for real? Investigated? I don't know. This is but I want to point to Miss Universe. She's Filipina and Australian. So Filipino-Australian, that makes her a flossy, I guess.
but the Filipino that I like yes. the most.
Yes.
The bravest.
The bravest, Brad.
And the one who has the most scars, because he has to share a bed with this woman, Kellyanne Conway's husband.
Yeah, George Conway. Yeah, you know, it's funny. I don't know George Conway personally. I mean, although we share a lot of things in common, because, you know, he went to Harvard. I went to Harvard. He went to Harvard Law. That's where the
comparison. You hate Kellyanne Conway? He hates Kellyanne Conway?
Yeah. You know, my wife, who is sort of like, she's less emaciated than Kellyanne Conway, but she is a blonde. She was on an airplane with her once, and she wanted to talk to her about something, but she didn't. She just decided. Maybe she needs her space, because everyone sees it's Kellyanne Conway. Just let her be. But I
can you imagine being married to her and fighting with her? I watched her the other night with Chris Cuomo on CNN. Yeah. I didn't say that. I didn't say we're going to take the kids to summer camp. You said we're going to take the kids to summer camp. I said I was interested in taking the kids to summer camp, but I don't have time to drive them up to summer camp. Why would I have said that?
See,
You're making up stuff.
You know, Filipinos have this thing for blondes generally. And, you know, and she's really dangerous, because not only is she blonde, but she's Catholic. And Filipinos are Catholic, and they love these blondes. And you know why the Filipinos love blondes? It's because of Mae West. Mae West was the patron saint of Filipino men back in the 1920s and 30s, because the Filipino men would come in as mostly boxers. That was like the top of the heap for Filipinos when you know, society was like throwing stones at Filipinos and saying, you can't marry, you can't do this, you can't do any jobs. So the Filipinos were all boxers. And when the boxers, when they retired, who was there to help them? Who was there to like hire them and let them be her driver and part of her Lilliputian army of protectors? But Mae West.
Really?
And that's why, yeah, I swear to God. I mean, Mae West hired more Filipino boxers, you know, in their, you know, in their retirement phase, because, you know, once you know, finish being a palooka, what do you do? A Filipino palooka, they sought the refuge under Mae West. So I think that's where the whole thing about Filipinos and blondes come in. But Kellyanne Conway is no Mae West. She is no Mae West.
Okay, that theory is almost crazy enough for me to believe it. Let us talk about diction, shall we? Because
is your diction vegan, David? I know you like to say you're a vegetarian, but
I'm a vegetarian, and you're saying we need to examine how we use words, not just how we eat, but how we use words. You're saying when it comes to veganism, there are many ways to skin a cat.
Oh, well, don't spare the cat. Spare the cat. Better choice of words, David. We can.
Oh.
Yeah. You know, I mentioned camels earlier. We could spare the camels. You know, the camels, you know, they're racing camels in the United Emirates, and they're hiring kids to be, you know, essentially slaves as their jockeys. We could spare the camels. Spare, you know, idioms. What are idioms? But they're expressions of language that reflect what goes on in society, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we don't want these negative things spread as, you know, as part of our, as to show how ingrained they are in society. We should extricate them. We should, you know, so when you use a term like beat a dead horse, right?
Mm-hmm.
Not to beat a dead horse, David, but but when you use a term like that, for goodness sakes, change it to PETA suggests feed a fed horse. So there's no violence. You're actually feeding the horse has been fed a second time.
That's very sweet. Okay.
It's a very, instead of bring home the bacon,
say,
bring home the bagels. Look, it's non-sectarian.
It's, and it's kosher. And it's kosher.
It's kosher. It's kosher.
Yeah,
come on.
I like
you know,
it.
And, you know, PETA said, started this campaign at the beginning of the month, around the first week, and got creamed. Social media, everyone started dumping up, PETA, what are you doing? This is not they were saying PETA was trivializing matters, you know.
I have the one.
Yeah.
The early bird catches the morning erection.
That's a Cialis joke.
Uh-huh. Go ahead.
Yeah,
I like this.
But the early, well, I guess that's a good thing. That could be a good, that's not a negative thing.
No.
Or how about pulling the wool over people's eyes? See, now, something else? I mean, I'm not wool, because a wool.
Suppose you've hired a sheep to sit on your face.
That would be better. That would
okay.
be, because then everyone gets paid. The sheep gets paid. You know, he's not harmed. You get to walk around with the big carcass on your face, and you're warm.
What about you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it drink it? That's sweet.
See,
you're not forcing. You're not waterboarding a horse.
That's true. Okay, there's some gray areas. There's some gray areas that where you might say that, but certainly you wouldn't want to. Let's see. What's another one? How about this idea that take the bull by the horns? If you're grabbing the bull, that's not very nice.
No. No, that's a bad expression.
What if you take the rose by the thorns?
Oh. Now,
that's a gentle, poetic one.
Yes,
even.
Very nice. I like that.
You know, and it's you know, it has a, it suggests the same kind of, you know, delicateness that, you know, taking the bull by the horns is, you know, I don't know. Have you done that lately?
No.
See, I mean, it's a tough thing, but
taking
the rose by the thorns. Right. That's tougher. All right. So
I'm a little on the fence when it comes to beating a dead horse, because once it's dead, you're letting off a little steam. You're not hurting anybody.
Oh, how about the? No, but you had to beat it, right? You had to. It's not dead yet. That's the thing. And it's because we wanted to get more out of them. Like, one more time around Central Park, you know, and they just kept beating the dead horse. How about this one? Let the cat out of the bag. That sounds good, but that's not so good. Let the cat out of
the bag. Who puts cats in a bag?
Some bad bag person. I don't know. Let the cat out of the bag.
That dog don't hunt. That's a good thing.
That dog. No, that dog don't hunt. Once again, hunting.
It's saying the dog doesn't hunt, that he's secure enough.
You got a bad dog, so now you got to beat it.
Yeah.
Or all those dog ones, let sleeping dogs lie. That's not a good one.
How about a cat always lands on its feet? That's sweet.
It depends. I mean, let a cat always lands on its feet. Well, what if it lands on top of the sheep that's sitting on top of your face?
What about a leopard not changing its spots? That's good.
Well, I don't know if you want to get into GMO leopards. I just don't think that.
You don't like killing two birds with one stone. What's wrong with that?
Feed two birds with one scone. Oh,
but that's nice. Yeah, and scones are high in sugar, so you're actually killing.
Well, if you in moderation, everything in moderation, right? But the fact is, you're not stoning any birds, and you're feeding them.
But scones are simple carbohydrates. They're very dangerous.
They are. Look, I'm not one for scones. They're kind of heavy weighted things, but like in moderation. I mean, they're not donuts.
Yes.
Donuts are worse. Donuts are worse than scones.
Talk to me about coyote trim. Now, I know about coyote ugly. Mm. I've never had coyote trim. What is
trim? Trim has such bad connotations these days. You know, I don't.
What is I?
You know, it's just that I'm of a generation where trim is trim, not trim. You know what I mean?
Coyote trim. I've seen some winter coats that have coyote trim on it.
Oh,
the
that
hoods.
Trim. That, yes,
the
that
hoods.
Kind. The hoods. And you know what? That's bad. Why do you need to kill the entire coyote just for the damn trim?
Well, why do you have to kill it? Can't they just shave a coyote?
It is not like getting a haircut. I know. It makes it – people make it sound like, oh, just get a haircut. You know, you'll just take – you know, pluck the feathers, they'll grow back. No. It's much more violent than you'd imagine. And for coyotes, if you go to PETA.org, there's a video that shows people – you know, they trap the coyotes. They trap them, and sometimes they don't catch coyotes. Sometimes they catch innocent – dogs and cats and pets and things like that, animals that they don't use, but they kill anyway because they get trapped. And then once, if they get the coyote, that coyote stays there until they check, the trappers check back with their traps, and sometimes it could be days. And so it's in pain and agony and all that for a little bit of trim that's on your hood.
Well,
which
yeah.
doesn't make sense. Ken the Goose does it, and yeah. if you believe when they say that it's we do sustainable trapping, you know, it's you've heard the term greenwash,
yeah.
right? When it comes to global warming in this world or in this context, it's a form of greenwashing that does not wash.
Yeah.
So people, you know, it's cold there in New York. You're cold.
Yeah. But I just want to say to my listeners, be careful getting trim on your hood. Go ahead.
Yeah. I know. All right. So, but people should go to PETA.org to see where that trim comes from. Mm-hmm. It comes from these coyotes who are trapped, and Ken the Goose. It's one of the biggest, the down that the Ken the Goose uses. You know, people think, oh, well, you know, these are just recycled feathers. No, that's not recycled.
That's what
feathers.
I thought.
And they pluck them alive, or they pluck them when they're dead. Sometimes they think, oh, we pluck the geese when they're dead. Right. And so we're just recycling those feathers, and then we're using the geese for food, which sounds good, but what the geese go through to get to that point, you know, to their death, not so great. And so people should consider all the alternatives.
Like Grey Goose.
Grey Goose, I know.
That keeps you warm at night?
The way the world's going now, yeah, Grey Goose. Although, you know, I had some vegan wine the other day. Vegan extends to the alcohol world. And when I saw vegan wine on the menu, I said, I had to try it. Tasted just like, I mean, I think I got drunk in a different way.
What do you mean, no yeast?
No. They use a kind of skin when they ferment the wine, an animal skin.
Really?
And yeah. And in some cases, and so if they don't say this is a vegan wine, you can be assured that the standard in the wine industry is to use these some kind of animal membrane in the fermentation process. And so I was up in, of course, in Mendocino a couple weeks ago, and they were touting a vegan wine, and I've seen vegan wines elsewhere, and people can Google vegan wine. They can see that there is a thing. So this is just a matter of, look, if you want to be strictly vegan, look, this is sort of like being good, right? I mean,
you know, in LA, they make wine using the Mark fermentation process.
Mark.
Detective, you know, Mark fermentation. They just call the wine the N-word until it...
The N-word. Hey, you know, this whole thing about vegan language and vegan diction, mm-hmm. you know, I thought you were going to jump all over me for being like PC or something.
No.
But I was telling my wife, I said, you know, it's sort of like, you know, the PC version of Huckleberry Finn, you know.
Yes.
The Negro James version.
Now, if you're Filipino, it would be the feci movement, right?
What?
You don't pronounce your P's.
That's right. You're feci.
It would be the feces.
That would be the feci, right?
The feci movement.
You know, that and there was a good feci joke at the end of SNL last weekend, if you hung around. I mean, people just don't say feces anymore.
No.
I mean, how many people say feces? It's We should bring back feces.
Bring back feces, yes.
Versus Dookie. I mean, they said Dookie on the show and feces. And by comparison, feces is just so much more refined.
Mm-hmm. Before you go.
Yes.
Les Moonves. He's not going to get his $120 million. Former head of CBS. Yes.
Poor Les Moonves.
He's getting less.
He's getting less for he did more than moon those women. How are actresses going to get jobs now? That's what I want to know.
Well,
you know, they're going to change the standard. No, here's the thing about Les Moonves. He lied. And what we're seeing is corporate justice, corporations taking care of their profits on their own. You know, it didn't go to court, although maybe Les Moonves will sue them. Or I don't know. I mean, apparently there's a contract.
How about he goes to jail? How about locking him up?
Well, they could do that, but then we'd have to go into the real justice system, you know, and in the Trump world, you know, where, you know, rule of law, well, you know, maybe sometimes, but certainly this is an example of corporations policing themselves and saying, we're not paying out $120 million to this guy. He lied to us.
Yes.
You know, try to cover this up. I mean, that's where the legal breakdown is happening. Under our current circumstances, right? I mean, just within the last couple of days, ever since Michael Cohen came out and got his 3 years, and people were wondering, okay, he gets 3 years. What's Trump going to get? What is unindicted co-conspirator? What is individual number one going to get? You know, I mean, the reaction to all this is really astonishing, because in the old days, we'd say rule of law. We know what we think. We know what's going to happen. Let's let justice run its course. But instead, we have seen over the last couple of days people make excuses for this man, like, well, maybe there is another option besides justice. Maybe there's another option besides rule of law, like rule of whatever we say it is,
mm-hmm.
you know, and that's the thing about Les Moonves' case, because it does show that, hey, look, corporations, when it's their dime and they've got to cough up $120 million as part of a severance package, well, they're going to fight it tooth and nail. Forget the law. Forget contracts.
Forget the women who were raped.
Well, forget the – look, I don't mean to diminish their role.
No, but that's what they do. They're certainly not going to give $120 million to the women who were raped.
Well, yeah, they're not getting anything. I mean, CBS is going to keep its money, and they're going to probably do more of those, you know, PSAs with their, you know, the stars of their sitcoms talking about how good CBS is. But, you know, that's what they do, right? That's what corporations do. They'll say, hey, look, well, we'll just run a couple more ads, public service announcements, and forget the women.
If you see something, say something, unless you're being paid a lot of money not to say something.
Yeah, well, isn't that the truth, you know? And that was the thing that made me kind of upset that I was watching Miss Universe this weekend. You know, I was trying not to. I was trying to be good about it, but I was thinking, you know, this is the better Miss Universe. This is the PC Miss Universe, where every woman is doing something for women and saying nice things about women. And sure, they're like bouncing up on their like 6-inch stiletto heels in their bathing suit, just like they would walk down the beach. But, you know, I learned something from watching Miss Universe. There's something about confidence. Confidence that instills in a person.
Yes.
When you are like walking down a runway
in high heels,
millions of people watching you, and you're trying to like just not fall on your ass, and you're just trying to just, you know, hold that pose. That takes not just a lot of guts, but it takes a lot of confidence.
How did Miss Spain do?
Miss Spain, you know, that's the other thing. Yeah, Miss Spain kind of made it an important Miss Universe, because they changed the rules. They said, look, it was in Thailand, for goodness sakes. And in Thailand, they love that stuff, right? This was ready-made for Miss Spain. She did not make it to the finals, but they did make a big deal about her on the program. And I say, hooray. I mean, Thailand's a place where if you want all that stuff, you can get operations. I mean, it's the place for that thing. And Miss Spain, that was her coming out party, and I'm glad to see it happen mm-hmm. there. I don't think it would have happened if the pageant were in, say, in the United States,
right?
But in Thailand, you know, I was in Thailand 4 years ago, David. Have you ever been to a place where they held a beauty pageant? I mean, like a first class beauty pageant, like a Miss Universe.
Have you ever been? Atlantic City.
Yeah, I mean, but have you been in a hotel while they had it?
No.
I say I happened to be in Bangkok 4 years ago when they were having like an offshoot of a big international pageant. And my goodness, I'm a decent sized guy, but these women were giants. It was like being with NBA players. They're just these super tall specimens of, I don't even know you want to call it beauty. It's almost like a sideshow. You know, there's something freakish about these, but they're very nice.
Mm-hmm.
And they look good if you have a 36 inch TV or, you know, small, you know, you have some kind, they look good on television, I guess. I mean, but there's just something about them that struck me as being really strange and odd. But, you know, I happened to be in the same hotel, and I sat next to a couple, and we talked, and they were really very lovely people. It's just that this is their thing. They chose to be in this competition, and this is their lives. And this, they go from one thing after another. And, you know, Miss Philippines, she actually is this she's half Scottish because her father was from Australia and her mother is Filipina. And they're like my kids. And so I really related to this Miss Philippines because I think, oh, that could be my daughter if she was like, you know, five feet taller or, you know, and
I was going to say something.
Yeah. Yeah. But no, it was just interesting to see her. And I had a tremendous amount of empathy for the beauty queens due to my experience. You know, having talked to beauty queens during their off hours while they're waiting for their call, and then And then just knowing how hard it is to wear 5-inch heels,
yes,
and, you know, strut down the runway. I applaud them. And then into what the Miss Universe this year must have done to Donald Trump. I could just imagine Donald Trump saying, "Yeah, that was my world. I could be the emperor of the whole thing. That was my world. I wouldn't have to deal with Congress." You know, mm-hmm. I just hope he gets nostalgic. Maybe it's time for an abdication, is what I'm thinking.
Yes, yes.
Some kind of abdication.
Emil Guillermo, you should listen to him every week on the PETA podcast and read him over at the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund.
aldef.org/blog.
Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund. ALDEF.
Not to be confused with the ALDEF Comedy Jam.
Yes.
That was something else.
Great job. Stand in line for 1 second, sir.